Good evening. On behalf of Dr. N.G.R. Janaki College of Arts and Science, I welcome you all to this alumni lecture series organized by the departments of biochemistry, microbiology, and postgraduate departments of bioinformatics and applied microbiology. Our alumni have always done us proud. They are our torchbearers, and I'm very happy they are spread far and wide in different countries and in institutes of national repute. This lecture series will be delivered by our students who have graduated from the departments of biochemistry and microbiology, and it will be live on YouTube till the 30th of May. Their talk on opportunity in biosciences will definitely kindle the interest in students to pursue higher studies and research in the interdisciplinary area of life sciences. During this COVID lockdown, students must have heard so much on the microbiology, immunology, biochemistry, and pathology of coronavirus. This lecture series, I'm sure, will motivate and enlighten you to take up higher studies in the field of biosciences. Each and every speaker of this alumni series is an extraordinary student, highly passionate and motivated. I thank them for accepting our request and for sharing their views. I would like to thank our correspondent, Dr. Latha Rajendran, and Chairman Mr. Kumar Rajendran for supporting us in all our endeavors. I thank the faculty of both the departments of microbiology and biochemistry for organizing this webinar. I'm sure this will be a knowledge treat to all the participants. Wishing you all the best. Over to Dr. Lakshmi Priya.
Good evening to one and all gathered on this live streaming for the first day session of the alumni lecture series. The future belongs to those who believe in the beauty of their dreams. One such staunch believer of a dream is a proud alumna which made her hold the university first rank gold medal for the BSc Microbiology degree program for the batch 2012-2015. Her passion in genetic engineering and genomes made her pursue her post-graduation in genomics at the prestigious Madurai Kamaraj University, and again, the university gold medal very much belonged to her. She has skilled her hands on the techniques of PCR, genotyping, immunoassays, cell cultures, mutagenesis, and in bioinformatics too. She has worked in the animal model C. elegans, on which she studied the efficacy of probiotics against the pathogens of C. elegans. She has two international publications to her credit and has done three internship programs at IIT Madras. Her first intern was on cell signaling pathways involved in human breast cancer cell lines, followed by DNA methylation uncovering a permissive methyloma in cardiomyocyte differentiation, and the third intern in the field of DNA cryptography. Her areas of interest include genomics and molecular biology, oncology, RNA biology, and microbiology. She is the proud recipient of International Conference on Genomics Science Medal for her dissertation work on anti-pathogenic activity of E. coli NISL 1917. She holds DST Inspire Fellowship, through which she is currently pursuing her PhD program in molecular oncology at Cancer Institute, Chennai. I'm happy to invite the most ambitious and determined alumna, Ms. Deepa, to present on anti-pathogenic activity of E. coli NISL 1970 and to set the perfect tone for this alumni lecture series. Over to Ms. Deepa.
Thank you so much for the introduction, ma'am. Very warm welcome to one and all gathered here. Today I'm going to present my MSc research work entitled as Anti-Pathogenic Activity of a Probiotic E. coli Strain. Before moving into the topic, I just want to give a brief introduction about the probiotics. What are probiotics? Basically, according to the definition of WHO, probiotics are living microorganisms which, when administered in adequate amounts, confer a health benefits to the host system. So, the probiotics are the microorganism which will enhance the gut microbiome in different pattern. Like, for example, it will help the body to digest certain food products, and it helps the body to produce some vitamins like vitamin K, and it support the immune system by performing as a barrier, and it balance the health by producing proper digestive function. And then, there are different types of probiotics available so far. These probiotics can be classified in common terms as good bacteria and bad bacteria. We all know the bacterial flora is diverse, and the vast amount of bacterial flora are available in our environment. So, what these good bacteria is doing in our gut microbiome, and what these bad bacteria are doing in our gut microbiome. Basically, these good bacteria which helps the human to sustain a normal lifestyle. Such microorganisms are classified into three different groups. These are Bifidobacteria, Escherichia coli, and Lactobacilli. And there are numerous number of bad bacteria which is called as pathogens. So these pathogens are prone to the infections. And these good bacteria, like Bifidobacteria, these strains majorly helps to regulate the levels of other bacteria in the gut microbiome, and it modulates the immune response to invading pathogens, and it even prevents the tumor formation and reduces vitamins. And the second group is E. coli. So this E. coli, which is a common inhabitant of our human gut, and it involved majorly in the production of vitamin K2, which is an essential vitamin for the gut protein mechanism. And it also helps to keep away the bad bacteria away from our system. And the third major group is Lactobacilli. These Lactobacilli is commonly available in all the food products and you are consuming in the day-to-day life. These beneficial varieties produce vitamins and nutrients, and it boosts our immune system and protect against carcinogens. So, in our lecture today, we are going to talk about the major organism, which is nothing but this E. coli, and the strain is E. coli Bacilli. So, what are all the major group of organisms? As I mentioned earlier, like there are three major groups. This Lactobacilli includes different kinds of species like Lactobacilli casei, fermentum, helicobacter, and Lactis rudimentari, vulgaricus, and plantarum. Likewise, Bifidobacteria also includes different strains. Why commonly we are taking E. coli Bacilli as a strain? And before going in detail about this E. coli Bacilli strain, I just want to give a brief introduction about how this probiotic works. What is the mode of action and what mechanism this probiotic follows to get into our system, and how it fights against the pathogenic organism to protect us. The first mechanism is it competes for the nutrients. So how it competes for the nutrients? So this cartoon elaborately says, like, this is a pathogen, Salmonella, so it fight for the nutrient, which is nothing but iron molecule, and E. coli Bacilli, which is, as I mentioned earlier, it is a probiotic organism. They are fighting for the nutrients. This is this mechanism is commonly termed as competition. So the first mechanism is competition for nutrients, and the second mechanism is blocking of adhesion sites. In this, what the probiotic organism will do is probiotic organism will go and adhere on the surface of the gut, so that it prevents the entry of the pathogenic microorganism into the system. So, and the third mechanism is immune stimulation. Immune stimulation is nothing but it triggers all the immune cells, and so that the immune cells will capture the pathogenic microorganism and it degrade it. And the last major mechanism followed by this probiotic organism is direct antagonism. So it directly fights with the pathogenic microorganism. And this fight is like do or die fight, so that the mostly the group of probiotics are already adhere on the surface of the gut will fight with the pathogen efficiently, so it will degrade the pathogen completely. Yeah. And why we choose E. coli as probiotic? E. coli is a commonly available strain, and as I told, like, it is a common inhabitant of the gut. So, one of the major important strain of probiotic E. coli is E. coli Bacilli 1970. And this is one of the best investigated and therapeutically used E. coli strain in the world. And I just want to give a brief history of how the strain has been discovered and what is the history behind it. Like, there is a professor named as Alfred Bacilli. He was worked as a physician in World War, and he was examining there is an outbreak of enteric pathogenic infection during the World War. The soldier was suffered. So what he did is he examined the stool sample from the officer, who were sick and who were healthy. So from the healthy organism, he found a particular strain of E. coli which behaved in a similar way to probiotic. He was discovered the strain in 1917. In 1917, a person who doesn't know the term probiotic, because probiotic was a term was established only in 1954. So before the establishment of the term probiotic itself, this Professor Alfred Musil coined probiotic as a E. coli mussel. So this strain has got this name as E. coli mussel 1917, because 1917 is the year when they discovered the probiotic bacteria. So it has a history of close to 100 years, which is safe, and it has uninterrupted use in medicine. There is no antibiotic resistant propagation for this bacteria, and it is even suitable for immunocompromised individual. So what is the characteristic feature of this strain? How it differs from other E. coli strain, like other pathogenic E. coli strain? There are n number of pathogenic E. coli strain. So why it is different and why it is commonly called as probiotic? Because it doesn't produce any enterotoxins, and it even doesn't produce any cytotoxin. It has a lipopolysaccharide which will majorly helps this bacterium to integrate on the membrane and to protect the membrane. This ECM and the intestinal epithelial cells are linked. This connection leads to the strengthening of the epithelial barrier. This epithelial barrier will act as a gate so that the pathogen could not able to invade, and it prevent like a preventing factor. And then this ECM has the ability to polarize nicely into the membrane, and it can even inhibit the growth and killing of pathogens. And the other important characteristic feature of E. coli mussel is it is beneficial in pregnancy. Most of the probiotic bacteria might cause adverse effect during pregnancy and even further full time, like preterm babies and all. But this E. coli mussel doesn't produce any adverse effect during pregnancy, and they have conducted a study in which they made E. coli mussel as a normal probiotic, and they given from the day one of her life, and it doesn't produce any adverse effect. And the commercially available probiotic product is Nutraflo, Symbioflo, and Holy Infuse. So these are this picture represented. Shows that E. coli, it is an aerobic organism. From day one itself, it started colonizing nicely, and it has been maintaining its capability in the gut microbiome comparatively with the other probiotic microorganism like Lactobacillus, Bifidobacterium, and Enterococcus. And then we have talked much about this probiotic organism, which is a good bacteria. Now, I just want to give a brief information about the pathogenic microorganism which we have used for our research work. So, gastroenteritis is one of the most common illness for infants and adults worldwide. These gastrointestinal tract infections can be categorized into three major groups. The group are like diarrheal disease, acute enteric disease, and non-diarrheal disease. So we have taken each organism from each group. For diarrheal disease, we have taken Listeria monocytogenes, and strain is Listeria monocytogenes 839. Why we have commonly picked up the strain is Listeria monocytogenes is a foodborne pathogen, and it is the major common cause for the stillbirth and the abortion. So in order to prevent such kind of infection during pregnancy, this probiotic can be administered and it can be used. In order to understand the mechanism of Listeria monocytogenes with ECM, the strain has been picked up. And the next category is acute enteric disease. This strain is especially used in order to understand how the species variation of Escherichia maintains its homeostasis. And then the third one is non-diarrheal disease. For non-diarrheal disease, we have chosen antibiotic resistant bacteria, which is nothing but methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus. And coming to the topic, the main objective of the study is to find out the interaction between E. coli mussel 1917 and enteric pathogens in gastrointestinal epithelial cells. We using KCO2 cell line as a model system, and Sener haploidase elegans, which is nothing but C. elegans as an animal model system. And the second objective is to investigate the cytotoxicity effect of E. coli nozzle against the enterobacterium in the cell line model system, which is KCO2 cell has been used as a cell line model. And the third objective is to study the establishment of E. coli nozzle and gastroenteric pathogens in the intestinal mucosa of C. elegans and assessing the viability of nematodes. What are all the methods followed to take care of the objectives? So the bacterial strains or plasmids used for this study is methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus, which has been, and enteropathogenic E. coli, Listeria monocytogenes. This MRSA and EPEC has been brought from ATCC, American Type Culture Collection, and Listeria monocytogenes 839 is brought from Microbial Type Culture Collection, Chandigarh, and Listeria monocytogenes 839 tagged with the GFP. GFP tag was performed in laboratory, and E. coli is in 1917. It is a gifted strain from RV from Germany, and this other strain RFP tagged E. coli is in 1917. It is also made in laboratory. And the culture cell lines used for the study is like KCO2 cell line monolayer, and it has been maintained in DMEM media with 5% NPS. And the animal model used for the study is C. elegans. It was maintained in nematode growth medium at 25 degrees Celsius. And the feed for the nematode is E. coli OP50. It is a common feed which is commonly used for the growth of C. elegans. And this picture depicts the confluency of the KCO2 cells. Here you can see the cells were only 50% confluent in nature, but here 90 to 95% of cells were confluent. Confluent is nothing but the complete the pattern of the cell. The monolayer has been formed nicely. And the one more other reason for the usage of KCO2 cell monolayer is it has a microvilli brush type villi pattern, and the other one is it has tight junction mechanism, so that it resembles the small industrial microflora. So that is the main reason why we preferred this KCO2 cell line as a model system for this study. Let us move to the results part. So first part of the result is, as I told, like we have to understand how this E. coli nozzle work against Listeria monocytogenes. So the cell lines were maintained, it has grown to 90 to 95% confluency at 37 degrees Celsius with a medium of DMEM and 5% FBS. So the cells has been cultured first. The cells has been cultured nicely for the confluency, and then ezin has been treated with the cell for around 2 hours, so that this the addition of the ezin will be in a perfect manner. This has been reported previously, but they doesn't report whether the ezin has the ability to compete with Listeria monocytogenes or not. So in order to understand, we have performed this experiment and found interestingly that here you could see that ECN has nicely colonized on the membrane. This is the nuclei. The nuclei is stained with host, and this is the RFP tagged ECN. So this ECN has adhered on the cell. But when we comparatively check the CFU value, what we have observed is the adhesion, though the adhesion of ECN was there, but the Listeria monocytogenes adhesion was more common when compared to the ECN adhesion. So, as I told in the beginning slides, there is a different mode of action for the probiotics, like competition, displacement, adhesion, and direct fighting, which is antagonism. So, here it is clear that Listeria monocytogenes doesn't adhere properly. And then the next mechanism is competition. So here, how this Listeria monocytogenes compete with this? For the competition mechanism also, Listeria monocytogenes compete more than ECN. So it doesn't follow this mechanism. The ECN doesn't kill the Listeria monocytogenes in this form. Here you could see the GFP tag Listeria monocytogenes and RFP tag. Yellow color is RFP tag, which has been shown in yellow color in high content screening, and this green color is GFP tag Listeria monocytogenes. Here these pathogens are competing for the cells, And the third strategy is displacement. Displacement is nothing but when the cells has been already adored. So the, what this ECN is doing is it will go and replace the place of the Listeria monocytogenes. So it is following a different pattern with Listeria monocytogenes because it is a foodborne pathogen and it is a even gram positive organism, so that it follows different mechanism for Listeria monocytogenes. Here you could clearly see that E. coli, the colony forming unit of E. coli is tenfold higher comparatively to the pathogenic organism. So from this it is clearly established that this Listeria monocytogenes follows the way, like it uses the mechanism displacement as a strategy to compete with Listeria monocytogenes, and it produces the efficacy of the ECM is much higher in Listeria monocytogenes strain. And this is a viability assay. The cell viability assay, here in cell viability assay, why we are doing cell viability assay is in order to understand whether this ECN has the ability to reduce the viability of the cell. Viability is nothing but the life and death assay. And the here control is that it doesn't have any pathogen or any probiotic, only the cell line. So the cells are 100% viable. On addition of the ECN, the cells were approximately 100% viable. And when Listeria monocytogenes are treated, the half of the viability has been completely reduced. This viability assay is majorly performed by using MTT. And the last one is Listeria monocytogenes and ECN. When the Listeria monocytogenes are treated primarily, and then the ECN, E. coli nasal, has been treated after the Listeria monocytogenes, what happens is the same mechanism happens here. Listeria monocytogenes go, it will fight with E. coli nasal, so that the E. coli nasal will win the war, and this E. coli nasal will take over the places so that the viability of the cell is rapidly increasing. So at 20-fold, like 20% of the viability has been profusely increased when Listeria monocytogenes is treated with E. coli nasal. So from this it is clearly distinguished that Listeria monocytogenes doesn't have the potential to sustained with E. coli nasal 1970. And the next strain we are going to see is enteropathogenic E. coli. So for enteropathogenic E. coli, here I have clearly mentioned, like I mentioned earlier for the first pathogen, clearly for the first pathogen, here for the second pathogen, like the enteropathogenic E. coli, again we have developed a technique for three different strategies, like addition, competition, and displacement. Here it is clearly mentioned that E. coli is competing perfectly. The war of competition was won by E. coli nasal 1917 comparatively to other two mechanisms. For adhesion, there is equal amount of adhesion that have been observed. There is only mild amount, like 0.2% variation has only been observed in the inhibition of adhesion. And even in displacement, there is no such huge variation. But in addition, we can be able to suspect like around, we have diagnosed like around the 10-fold increase has been observed during the competition mechanism for ECN versus EPIC. So the war has been won by ECN. And the next pathogen we have used is MRSE, methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus. In this mechanism, what happened is MRSA has the ability, it is well established that MRSA has the ability to adhere on the cell surface in a very nice pattern manner. But here, it is even clear that ECN has the ability to adhere even more when MRSA doesn't able to disrupt the ECN. So the adhesion of the ECN is much more compact when compared to the MRSA. So MRSA follows the pattern of adhesion. So these three different, we only took three different pathogens, and these three different pathogens took three different strategies. Like ECN has depicted in three different manners. Like for Listeria monocytogenes, it has been used a displacement strategy, and for EPEC, it compete perfectly with the ECN. MRSA. For MRSA, it used this inhibition of adhesion as a strategy. So this ECN is multipotent failed to fight with pathogenic organisms. And in order to confirm whether the same mechanism has been established in the animal model, so we have further used the C. elegans as a model system. Here we could see like C. elegans. This is the complete picture of the C. elegans. I hope it is clear. First, what we did is we have fed the C. elegans for 6 hours. 6 hours, after 6 hours, the image has been photographed in high content screen in 40x resolution. So here you would see that Listeria monocytogenes has been colonized nicely in the gut mucosa of the C. elegans. And after 12 hours, the more amount of Listeria monocytogenes has been colonized, and 24 hours, the complete Listeria monocytogenes have been colonized. So the CFU of Listeria monocytogenes perfectly depicted the here. So in 6 hours, only few amount of Listeria monocytogenes is colonized. So here it is mentioned here. And in 24 hours, the number has been drastically raised, and in 48 hours, it is maintained. So, in order to understand how this ECN and Listeria monocytogenes co-colonization would help with the longevity of the C. elegans. So, to understand this, ECN has been fed to the nematodes, pre-treated nematodes. So, this ECN is pre-treated to the nematodes, and then the Listeria monocytogenes has been infected to the nematodes. So for this panel here, what happened is, like for 12 hours of ECN pre-treatment and 6 hours of Listeria monocytogenes infections. So here we could see that the colonization of Listeria monocytogenes and the merged, here you can see the yellow color depicts the colonization of ECN. ECN has been colonized nicely in the gut mucosa, so that this Listeria monocytogenes couldn't be able to completely adhere on the mucosal pattern. So for 12 hours of infection, so here that in for 12 hours it is even more clear, like the Listeria monocytogenes couldn't be able to strive on the intestinal mucosa. Mostly it doesn't able to cope up with ECN, and for 24 hours the number has been reduced. The Listeria monocytogenes infection rate, multiplicity of infection has been completely reduced when compared to the previous time period. So this bar graph again shows the same pattern. For 6 hours, the Listeria monocytogenes is in the upper hand, but after treatment, what happened is, like Listeria monocytogenes taken upper hand. So for 6 hours, of infection, it is necessary for the ECN to establish its point. So after 6 hours, what happened? The Listeria monocytogenes taking its upper end. So the lifespan assay is again showing like how much potentially the Listeria C. elegans can be able to cope up with this ECN, and it can increase the longevity of its point. So here, this blue color shows that it is a control. Control is feed OP, E. coli OP 50, and this dotted lines represented ECN, and this plain red line represented ECN plus Listeria monocytogenes, and this dotted pink line represented Listeria monocytogenes. And here we can clearly see the ECN has the ability to maintain its lifespan, but Listeria monocytes, this dotted red lines, will decrease the lifespan. The C. elegans which feed it with Listeria monocytogenes has been completely, the complete culture has been diseased at 70th hour. And next we are going to see about how this immunopathogenic E. coli works with the ECN in nematodes. So here it is clearly mentioned that ECN and EPEC. So here it is for both E. coli Escherichia species, like EPEC as well as E. colinism, both are from different sources. One is a pathogenic microorganism, and another one is the probiotic microorganism. So here E. coli doesn't have the common ability to control it in an earlier stage. So it is commonly called as slow killer. So here in 24 hours, the colonization of EPIC is drastically increased comparatively to the other time point, but at 48 hours, it is in null phase. The dual colonization of ESN in EPIC, it clearly shows that this RFP tagged ECN has the ability to colonize much higher than this EPIC. And then for MRSA, what happened? For MRSA also it followed the same pattern. But what happened here is when the time point increases, the colonization of ECN has been getting higher and higher when the time gradually increases. But during the initial time point, the MRSA was in upper hand. So the same pattern was being followed for three pathogens, and we beautifully observed that the MRSA, EPIC and Listeria monocytogen doesn't have the ability to compete with ECN, so that it reduces its efficacy in 24 hours of infection, and ECN is well established during this hour. So this lifespan assay for MRSA and EPIC also depicted that EPIC at 70th hour and for MRSA at 100th hour. It completely, the total population of the nematode has been completely diseased. But here you could see that when EPIC has been treated with ECN, the lifespan has been increased, the longevity of the CL against has been increased. So from this, what we could say, like, what is the significance of the study is, ECN protects the host system from the pathogenic stresses and it significantly reduces the infection. The probiotic E. coli Nessel 1917 was found to be potent enough to maintain the viability of cells during gastroenteric infections caused by MRSA, EPIC and Listeria monocytogenes. So this study, this work was done on 2017. I have submitted to the MSc registration project on 2017. So what are all the recent updates on E. coli Nessel? I just want to give a few glimpse of updates about E. coli Nessel 1917. So these one article which shows that effects of E. coli Nessel 1917 on exercise induced disruption of gastrointestinal integrity. Here what they are telling is, like, E. coli Nessel has the ability to even disrupt the gastrointestinal integrity. And the other such one paper, which is a very recent paper, and what they have mentioned is it has an anti-cancer property and it works against HT29 colon cancer cells through the regulation of BAGS, BSL-XL and AKT-PTEN signaling pathways. So it can be even used as a chemotherapy to treat colon cancer. And one another such paper is bioengineered E. coli Nessel 1917 for tumor targeting therapy. This tumor targeting therapy is nothing but the engineer the E. coli Nessel in such a way that it will go and compete on the cancer cell and it will completely demolish the population of the tumor. Yeah. So that's all about the project, and I just want to give a small glimpse about how I started my career in research and what made me to choose research as my career. Yeah, today I'm here only because of all my teachers, and especially I want to thank my mother department of microbiology and biochemistry for being complete support for me. And I did my undergraduation in Dr. N.J. Janaki College in the stream of microbiology. And then I pursued a master's degree in Madurai Kamaraj University. I pursued master by clearing the entrance examination. And I, for UG, there are the scope. I just want to give a brief about like how, what are the scope of research as a career after UG and PG, and what how I chose research as a career. So after UG, there are vast options. We can go for job, we can opt for higher studies, we can write national level exams like integrated PhD courses offered by national institutes like TIFR, ISERS and some IITs. and there are many central and state universities exams. So we can write. I wrote one such state university exam, which is nothing but NSC national level eligibility test for genomics, which has been conducted by PPT IPLS program from Madurai Kamaraj University, and I cleared the exam and the interview, and then I get into the course. And MKU was one such place where you can get access to each and every part of the research. All the teachers, I want to thank all my teachers from the Department of Genetics and School of Biological Sciences from Madurai Kamaraj University. I have learned so many techniques from Madurai Kamaraj University. And then one can clear GRE and opt for international courses abroad. And there are many free internships, you can say, like they will pay and you go and learn something. There are many different types of internships are available. You can get into IIT as an intern, you can get into NIT as an intern, you can get into ICER as an intern. There are so many national institutes in our country. So one can apply for the internship. There are some rules, like you have to write a proposal of your interest, like what you have to learn from their lab, like what you want to establish. In such way, you have to write a proposal, a small proposal or a personal mail to the respective guide or respective teacher whom you like to work with. So you can write some small proposals and mail them, and you can. There is so many options available for the internships. So I don't recommend one can pay and go and learn. You have they will pay you for the learning purpose. So you try to opt such internships so that it will be useful. It will be definitely useful for one to build a career in the research field. And then what one can do after post graduation is, they can again opt for state and central government exams like UPSC and TNPSCs. And if one is opting for the higher studies, like one will step into research, they have to definitely clear some exams like CSIR, DBT, DST Inspire. DST Inspire is not an exam, but it is for the university first rank holders. So you have to write, there are two modes of selection for the DST Inspire. One selection is provisional selection and the other selection is final selection. For provisional selection, what one has to do is one has to write in elaborate a proposal for the 5-year PhD degree program, and they have to get consent from three personal investigators, three different guides, and they will assess your proposal, they will assess your profile, and then they will call you for the final call. So this will take around 3 months. And then if you are opted for the provisional selection, within 1 year, you have to search for a lab so that you can get into the lab as a DST Inspire fellow for doing your full-time PhD degree program. Again, you have to write your own proposal. For all these proposal writing and all, one has to be strong enough in basics, which I have learned and acquired from, again, from my mother department, Department of Microbiology. And the other such exams is ICMR, ICAR. There are some abroad fellowships like that. One can opt if someone wants to go to Germany and study. So there are so many joint programs as well. Like one can switch 2 years in Madurai University in India and 2 years in abroad university. For government or governments are signed MOU so that you can be able to join PhD program. And there are other institutes like Tata Institute of Fundamental Research and BARC and other central university and state university exams are there, and they will give their own fellowships. And IITs is conducting their own exams, ICERs are conducting their own exams. They are coming under MHRB so that they will give their own fellowships. And recently, Prime Minister Research Fellowship has been released so that one can even get a nice pay for doing research, for taking research as a career. And international options, like if you can clear GRE and opt for top universities in US, UK, Canada, Singapore, and other international universities. So these are all the scope one can have after UG and PG life science. And there are a lot of other scopes as well. And now I am pursuing my PhD degree program as an Inspire Fellow in the Department of Molecular Oncology, Cancer Institute. And I told you, right, there are two different ways for getting into Inspire Fellowship as a university first rank holder. One has to write a proposal and go through this provisional selection board, or you can go and join. In the second mode is you can go and join PhD somewhere in India, and you can get write a proposal and get consent from Inspire for the fellowship. And then I want to acknowledge DPT IPLS program, DST FIST, Department of Genetics in the School of Biological Sciences, NBU, and Department of Microbiology, Dr. N.J. Janaki College, Department of Biochemistry, Dr. N.J. Janaki College, and all my teachers, friends, colleagues, seniors, and parents, and the entire family. And I want to specially thank my favorite teacher, Dr. Lakshmi Priya, who made me to write the entrance of Madurai Kamaraj University. If she doesn't insist me to write an entrance, I won't be here in front of you to talk in a lecture, because she dragged me and she pulled into the university. So I'm indebted to her for my lifetime, and I want to thank the whole Department of Microbiology, Dr. Sumitra ma'am, and Dr. Ramya ma'am, each and every one of them. They were like it was like my other home. I won't feel like I'm somewhere in college or something. So it felt like other home. I recommend and I request all my juniors and all my friends to take this research as one of the career option and do some useful need for the society through in terms of research. And the question section.
It was indeed a wonderful work and a very clear presentation. And of course, thank you too by the participants. Let me read that you can answer. Question is from, she's asking, ECN lab classical of the hello? Yeah, there's a question from Devika. She's asking, ECN lacks the classical virulence factor. So what contributes to the probiotic activity of ECN at the genetic level?
It is true that ECN doesn't have any virulence factor. And how this ECN has the ability in the genetic level, in the sense is it has addison, addison has been coded profusely in the genome. So what happens is ECN will adhere perfectly on the mucosal layer so that it prevents the entry of the pathogenic microorganism. So that is the main reason of why this ECN acts as a probiotic. And what is the exact candidate gene which made ECN as a probiotic is still under study. And there are some techniques like insertion sequencing where the transposon has been used as a mutational agent. So the transposon will go and sit throughout the genome. So the sequencing of these transposable elements can be able to detect the candidate gene. So this study was still going on. The candidate gene is ectodesimal.
Okay. The second question is, what is the mechanism of action of ECN?
Mechanism of action of ECN is, as I told, we have took three different pathogens, and the mode of action is it requires different mode for different pathogens. For example, here we saw example like for Listeria monocytogenes, it uses displacement as a mechanism. It replaces the place of the Listeria monocytogenes and it develops its own pattern. And for EPEC, it compete with the EPEC. And it holds a space. And the third one we saw is MRSA. And for MRSA, what it does is it adheres so that it won't allow the MRSA to get into the cell system. So it follows different mechanism for different pathogens based on the pathogenic microorganism. It is multifactorial probiotic mechanism.
Okay. The other question is, she's asking about the immunomodulatory properties of ECN. What all you have checked the as the immunomodulatory properties?
For immunomodulated properties, E. coli has a pro-inflammatory cytokines like interleukin-10, IFN-gamma. There are some pro-inflammatory cytokines and other such immune cells which can able to capture the foreign antigen so that it won't develop or it won't allow the foreign organism to get into the system.
The next question is from Kavita. She's asking, how do you think that ECM will be used in future?
ECM can be used in cancer treatment. Like last update slide, I mentioned like ECM, bioengineered ECM has been developed. So what they will do is they will clone the ECM in such a way they will go and target the cancer cell. For example, one paper has shown that it triggers the BAGS and the AKT P10 signaling pathway. So what they have performed is they engineer the E. coli in such a way it go and adhere on the tumor cells so that it the population of the tumor cells is completely devastated by this probiotic E. coli. So the research is still going on. It was done in animal model, but it takes some more years for the clinical trials.
For cancer treatment and other such therapeutic purpose. Okay. The next question is why C. elegans being a nematode is actually used for developmental biology, but I chosen specifically C. elegans for your study.
One common thing is like C. elegans as a we all know that it is used for the developmental biology studies and neurobiology studies. And like why we have used C. elegans for this purpose, it has a well-established gut intestinal gut mucus as well. So the gut, we have to understand whether the adhesion factors of this ECN has the ability to get into the system or it requires any other factor to get into the system. In order to understand the concept, we have used C. elegans. And one other factor is C. elegans is very easy to handle. And it is it can very easily grown in lab and it is very cheap compared to the other animal model. And these are all very handy and these are all the common factors why we are using C. elegans. And the major common reason is it has a very established intestinal mucosa. So that is why.
Okay. The next question is from Mamta. She's asking, does the toxins produced by any gastrointestinal pathogen could affect the activities of ECN or is there any chance of it getting pathogenic?
No, actually, there is any conjugation kind of problem can be happened with ECN and other such. Is it right?
No, she's asking the toxins that are produced by any gastrointestinal pathogen, will it affect the activities of the ECR? Any toxins or anything, will it affect ECR?
No, actually there was one work, they were worked with Ishika toxin. So what they, even it has the ability to work against the toxin substances like salmonellabacter, lectin and even Ishika toxin, it has the ability to compete well with the toxin substance as well. So it doesn't able to kill by the toxins. It can fight properly. Okay.
The next question is what is the commercial name like available for this probiotic and they are asking for what all diseases it can be given like, especially this E. coli ECN.
This commercially available product is Mutaflor and Simbiflor, polyinfants. These are all the three commercially available products in the prescribed form. So these are given for the infections like for kids and infants there is a diarrheal disease which is even lethal for them. So during the initial periods of like them the diarrhea occurs, the infection is definitely lethal for them for cholera toxin and for EPIC. So during that purpose they are giving this ECN Mutaflor as an agent to treat the infants. And during pregnancy, they are giving this as a to boost the immune system. And Crohn's disease, against Crohn's disease, they are using this. So there are a number of diseases nowadays. They are advising to take this E. coli missile as a probiotic system to make a good gut system.
Okay. The next question is, can probiotics be taken along with antibiotics? Like antibiotics are given for treatment. Like along with that, can you take antibiotics or probiotics has to be taken separately?
Antibiotic property is completely different from probiotic property. So we can't say that there are some other probiotics we are taking along with antibiotics, but here we can prefer prebiotics comparatively to the antibiotics. So the combination of prebiotics and probiotics, like symbiotics, we can take in terms of antibiotics, because the development of antibiotic resistance is much higher. So in order to control this antibiotic resistance, we can use the symbiotic as a therapeutic strategy.
Is there any future in genetically engineering of this ECN for better probiotic properties?
Yes, if we found out the candidate gene, like what we have like insulin, we are giving for diabetic as a separate factor. So if we are finding out such candidate gene from ECN, we can develop, we can engineer, bioengineer it, and we can take use, exploit the RDNA technology for the for getting a candidate therapeutics from
the ecology. Thank you, Deepa. I think we have almost answered for all the questions.
Yeah.
Thank you, Deepa, and I really appreciate the time you've taken to present and patiently answer the questions. Before we end today's session, I would like to notify about the tomorrow's speaker. The speaker for tomorrow is Ms. Ramani Sundaram of 2005 to 2008 batch from the Department of Biochemistry. She is currently the team lead, research, training and development, Nightingale Medical Trust, Bangalore. She'll be sharing her insights on avenues in socio-clinical care research from a neuroscience perspective. With that note, I thank all the participants for joining us and hope to see you all again tomorrow for the day 2 session at 5 p.m. Thanks for listening. Thank you all.